Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus the Christ. You might feel that it's strange, and for our society it is, because most of the time the preacher is standing and the congregation is sleeping. No, the congregation is seated. At the time of Jesus, it was the opposite way around. Jesus would actually sit down and the congregation would stand. So today we are in the tradition of the apostles and Jesus. I'm going to be seated many a times, and you will be listening and hopefully taking home with you what the Lord is trying to get across to you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, it is our privilege to come to you, and yet we so often treat it as a right. You know us better than we know ourselves, and we need to know from you that you really do care for us and will respond to us, even at those times when we are unable to understand what is happening in our lives. And so we ask that you give us the strength this morning. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Every community has some people that are not particularly appreciated, but they have a lot of power, and so that just feeds on itself. And in this particular community, there were two people, two brothers, who were just awful. I mean, they cheated people, they just never played by the rules, and they were very, very wealthy. On one occasion, one of the brothers died. And the remaining brother went to the pastor and said, "I know you don't really like us." He said, "But, you know, would you please make an exception? If you could bring yourself to call my brother a saint, I would be wonderful. I'd be glad to give you let's say $25,000 for the building program." That perked up the congregation. And the day came when the brother had died, and here they were. And what happened? Well, the brother said, "Look, I'd be glad to give you the money if you could work this into the sermon." And so the remaining brother and the people who were there decided that they really wanted to see what was going to happen. And the congregation, the building was just filled, and the sermon time came, and the preacher said, "You know," he said, "I have nothing good to say about the decedent. He was a liar, he was a cheater, he just did everything just for himself." He said, "But compared to his brother, he was a saint." So, that's what we're talking about today, the saints in our congregation. The saints in our congregation, often we don't understand what Jesus means when he calls people a saint. He's more prone to call them a children, as he did in this particular passage. He's more prone to be there with the person who is broken than the person who seems to have it all together. And so here we are in this congregation, and we could be caught up falsely by the whole notion that a saint is someone who does a lot of good stuff, who does a lot of good things, that a saint is someone who is able to get the attention of people and is able in some ways to live out a life of luxury because God has been there for him. Did you ever find yourself saying in prayers, "God, thank you for all that you've done for me"? Which is a wonderful prayer, but you know, when we put that together with the passage in Jesus compared to the Pharisee and the person who wanted to be recognized, the Pharisee, did not win out. It was the broken-hearted beggar who prayed the prayer that allowed him to be present for Jesus. And so it's easy for us to sort of get caught up in the whole notion that God himself is there for us and he's able to help us to do the things that we want, and we are saints when everything is going well and not when things are going poorly. So here we are listening to the passage where Jesus is saying to the disciples, hey folks, children of God. We are the children of God. We are the ones who are recognized by others, not because of all the things that God has given us, but because he is there for us when we need him and when he cares for us. And so when you look at the passage, we find in this particular passage, we find that Jesus himself refers to the children of Israel as children. He does so actually in the Gospel according to John. Let me pull that out. In the Gospel according to John, in the first chapter, believe me, it's in here. Verse 12, but to all who did receive him, receive Jesus, who believe in his name, Jesus, what do we pray? We pray in the name of Jesus. He was in one was coming into the world. He was the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. What does Jesus say? Is this some negative comment that Jesus is making? No. He actually, so frequently, when he's talking about his disciples and others, he talks about them as children. And he does, what does he say? Bring the children to me. Bring the children to me. And that's what All Saints Sunday is about. Bringing the children to him. In my study at home, I have a picture of my baptismal certificate. And in the baptismal certificate, there's Jesus sitting at the well with lots of children around him. And guess who's bringing the children to him? Luther. Luther. It's official. It's on my baptismal certificate. Luther is the one who actually brings the children. And that's what the Reformation is about. The Reformation that we celebrated last week is about Jesus receiving the children of God and asking others to bring them to him. If you have been frustrated this week in any way, children are frustrated. However, the mother a few moments ago was able to quiet that child, that's a sign to us. That's what Jesus wants for us. He wants us to be children of God as his saints.